keep you long because of what? You want to get back to class and food tray. Hey, listen, today we're here for celebrate Ryan Rolison signing his scholarship papers to Ole Miss. There's a lot of things that go into that, not only for Ryan, but for anybody that signs a scholarship. The amount of work, the dedication, the commitment, the sacrifice, it's amazing. So, first of all, let me just say congratulations to that. I'm going to start off with some numbers. According to Prep Baseball Report for the state of Tennessee, Ryan is the third-ranked high school, overall high school player in the state of Tennessee. Okay? He is the number one-ranked left-hand pitcher overall in the state of Tennessee for the class of 2016. According to the National Federation of High Schools for the United States, approximately there's 455,000 high school baseball players in the country. So if you break that down by class size, it's approximately 111,000 to 113,000 baseball players per class. This past summer, as most of y'all know, he was selected to play for the USA 18-under national team. Now, if you combine, because of the age groups of 18-under, mostly that's a combination of you're either a junior going into your senior year, or you're a senior going into your first year of college. So if you combine those two classes, that's somewhere around 225,000 baseball players. And there's only 20 out of that 225,000 eligible players, only 20 are selected to make that team. So if you do the math, is John Snapper in here? If you do the math, it comes out to about 1/1000th of a percent chance of making that team. And we got one guy sitting around here that did it. So I don't know. Most y'all know what a big deal that was, because the odds of doing that are astronomical, as you can see. From the history of the USA national baseball team since 1983, there have been 7 players in the state of Tennessee to make that team, and we've got one of them in USJ. How about that? All right, so anyway, that's about what he is. That's not who he is. He could have come back over the course of the summer, come back to school with this inflated ego, this big head syndrome. But he hadn't done it. He won't do it. His teammates won't let him, first of all. They call him out on it, but that's just not who he is. When I first started here 2 years ago, I'll be honest with you, I wasn't sold on him. I could tell he was good, but I wasn't sold on him. I was indifferent to him. He just wasn't catching my eye. He wasn't doing what he needed to do. But as the year went on, he got better. I think he tried or started to figure out what I wanted. So we go to the state tournament that year. And he pitches the first game, beats BGA, shuts him out, as a matter of fact. He throws 100-something pitches. 2 days later, we're playing Tipton Rosemark in the state championship game. Alex Garrett is on cruise control. So we get to the top of the seventh, and they're coming up to bat. Between innings, I had talked to Coach Davis, our pitching coach, and I said, "You think Ryan's got enough left in the tank that if we need him, that he can come in and finish this out?" He said, "Oh yeah, I think he does." So we start the top of the inning, and they get a guy on base. I don't know if it was after one out or no outs, but You know, my first year here, my first time coaching a state championship game, guess who gets nervous? That would be me. Hopefully I didn't show it. But I look at Coach Davis, I said, hey, get Rolison, go to the pins and start getting loose. He looks around and goes, where is he? I said, well, I don't know, where is he? Well, the knucklehead run down the bullpen by himself and started getting loose. And he was ready to come in. Thankfully, you know, Alex got the other outs. We got the dog pile. But that just tells you right there, he's a competitor. He wants to win. He'd do whatever he could to make that happen. Another thing about who Ryan Rolison is, and Stephanie. This picture was taken last spring. We had just beaten Christian Brothers to get third place in the USA Classic. And that's a tournament held in Memphis. It has about 30-something teams from all across the country. And we did really good in that tournament. So after the game, we decided to go get something to eat. We stopped at this barbecue place outside of Millington somewhere. And as you can tell, this is part of who Ryan Rolison is. He's just a big goofball. A lovable goofball. I don't know if he was practicing for the prom or what. But anyway, that's him in a nutshell right there. I mean, he's got a personality. I love him. You can relate. You can have a interaction with him. He's not scared to drop a barrier and let you know who he is. You know, to me, he's a lot of fun to be around. So this past spring, we're playing Davis Academy in the final game of the sub-state. And as I mentioned last Monday, it was just a knockdown drag-out, just a heavyweight boxing match. You know, it was just a great high school baseball game. After the game, you know, we're physically tired, we're emotionally drained. We are, we're excited. So we get in the bus and we packed up, we're coming home, and we decide we're gonna stop somewhere in Nashville. I don't know if this was on the way to where we were gonna eat or after, I'm not sure. But this is another example of who Ryan Rolison is, Miss Stephanie.
Different experience. you guys that don't know, my name is Scott Gunn, Derek's dad. And first, before I start, I left school this morning, and a teacher came to me and said, "Man, they need to change the Jackson Sun to the USJ paper because of all the signings from this senior class with Jack and Clayton and all the baseball guys." And I laughed, and I said, "Man, this is just, it's still early. There's a lot more to come, and it's a tribute to y'all's whole class, so congratulations." Got a special place in my heart. And I do feel like he's one of mine. I was trying to think of some words to come up with that describe him as far as baseball and also as a human being. And one of them was, we used to talk a lot growing up what the difference between a pitcher and a thrower. You know, a thrower, if you're a good team, you want to face that guy because, you know, a guy that just throws hard, throws right at you. Like 2 years ago when St. George tried to throw theirs and we scored 15 runs, I guess, against him. Last year we faced the kid from Lexington and, you know, killed him. So the difference between a thrower and a pitcher is a thrower's going to be just slinging. When Ryan was 11 years old, we were playing in the Fall Nationals in South Haven. And he was going to pitch against a team from Alabama. And they were good. So, first inning, they get bases loaded. Coach Carey tells me to go out and talk to him. And I go out there, and he looks at me and he's like, "What the heck?" You know, 11 years old, he's saying, "What are you doing?" "We got bases loaded, man. We need to turn two here. Give me a ground ball or something." And he says, "I got this." He ends up striking out the side, and I don't think he gave up another hit the rest of the game. Because that's when I knew he was going to be the pitcher. He knew how to pitch. He knew what he wanted. And, you know, he'll come inside. He'll throw it. At that time, we didn't throw curveballs, but he just knew what he wanted to do. And at that point, I knew we had something special. And he was going to be there. Second word was competitive. I have never coached a kid that wanted ball against the best teams, no matter what. And that's something that, as a coach, you just love to have. I mean, he wants that ball. You know, and the other thing was, the third word was winner, and it sort of goes back to competitive. Ron Ross is a winner. You know, I mean, he went this summer, my coach said, and competed in his tryouts for Team USA. This cat didn't give up a single earned run all summer until he gets to Japan, where he gets sick, he has tendonitis, and he gets to throw against Team Canada, throwing well, and all of a sudden he faces a guy that's just got drafted in the first round, and he hits a shot. And I was, you know, I was there, I was watching on the computer, and I mean, that was, like Gary said, that ball's still flying. So later in the game, I could tell, you know, he was hurting and being sick. The coach came out, and I knew, even before Gary told me what he told me, I said, there's no way he's going to take him out right now. And because this guy that just hit a home run off of is coming to play. And then Gary tells me later on that when the coach came out to pull him, Ryan says, uh-uh, coach. All right, one more. Let me get this one. What did he do? He struck him out. And that's Ryan. I mean, he competes in everything he does. Third thing is, well, the last thing is something that Coach Peel talked about. He just loves life. And there's never a dull moment. Maybe he sort of stretches the line a little bit. But he knows when to quit, but he just loves life. And if you're around him like you are, as much as you are, you know it's hard to be in a bad mood around. He's going to find something to make you laugh. And to me, that's the best compliment I think I could give, is just knowing how he is, being around him. And, you know, today's your day. And I don't know why, you know, when we were growing up, we played against the travel team Memphis Tigers, who I despise. When we finished playing, that's Coyotes. What does he do? He goes and plays for the Tiger team. He knows how big of a Memphis fan I am. And my own nephew's an student assistant football coach at Ole Miss. And even when they played University of Memphis, I told him, I said, I'm sorry. I got to root for the Tigers. Well, Ryan goes and signs with Ole Miss. But Ryan, I promise you from this day forward, I'm an Ole Miss fan. And I will be there. When you get there. When you get that call, I'll be there. I love you.
His biggest deal that he has going for, he is a dreamer. And you know, going back
some things I think we miss out on. We quit drinking for these kids. You know, y'all keep doing it, keep doing it. And it led to him committing to Ole Miss. When that commitment happened, I can't tell you how many people come up to me and they ask, man, is he good enough pitcher? I said, boy, can pitch. I said, man, those three pitches for a strike. But at that point in time, he was topping out about 84, 85. And then, like, overnight, the guy went to 89. And then 2 months after that, in Oklahoma, I saw him hit 92. I mean, that's just phenomenal. Plus, he grew like 4 inches in that same period of time. You know, God was looking out for him. He gave me a gift. And you know, March 25th of last year, you know what that date is? I'll tell you. Ryan changed his whole life that day. Because there was 10 to 15 scouts that showed up to watch this other guy pitch. And that week I got a call from an advisor. He wanted me to introduce him to that other pitcher, parents. They asked me, I know him. I said, yeah, I know him. And I said, but that's all good. I said, but I got some more parents I need to introduce you to. I said, because, man, he's one heck of a pitcher. And, of course, it was you. Well, that day, Ryan took that mound. Man, from the first inning, you saw God Almighty, he had unbelievable focus, unreal. I sat right behind the thing. I was like, God, this is something to watch. And it wasn't long, all them scouts started talking. It was like, man, this is the guy we need to see right here, this guy. And the St. Louis Cardinals scout called Gary, and he said, hey, we got to try for US-18. Man, he needs to be there. And sure enough, you know, everybody knows the story. Ryan Gomes, what an unbelievable accomplishment. And now he's on everybody's radar. You know, there'll be 30 teams that will put him through the ringer this spring. And you other people that play baseball, you don't know how much of a blessing it is to have a guy like that on your team. Because all these pro scouts talk to all these college coaches. And they're going to get to watch you play every time he takes the field. Every time he pitches, there'll be somebody here. Watch it. It'll become old hat to see scouts in the bleachers, man. It's pretty cool. And so to have that here is a huge honor for this school. And, excuse me. But here's the thing. So back to what we've learned from Ryan. It says, keep dreaming, number one. That's the most important thing. Because if you act it out, you never know, man. And number two, be ready for your day. Because you think about it, what if he wasn't ready on March 25th? What if he did believe all the hype that we were facing this super phenomenon guy? And he was great. He's in Mississippi State now, doing a heck of a job. But Ryan beat him that day. He showed the world what, man, what he could do. And boy, can he do it? He sure can. You know, and I said, well, no, God gave him gifts. He did. Comes a huge responsibility. Because there are going to be people, there'll be little kids that, you know, you don't know them. And you won't know they know you. And they're going to see everything. There goes Ryan Rolison right there. So it's a huge responsibility. Man, best advice, like Coach Billy said, man, you're a humble guy. Stay humble. Do what you didn't put here today. Sign that thing, Kat. Thank you.
Students, I've been with my whole life, teachers, coaches and family. It's a little bit out of my comfort zone, but I'm going to do my best. First of all, I want to thank my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for giving me the ability to be standing here today. Without him, there's no way I would have this great opportunity ahead of me. I want to thank Coach Bill and Coach Gibbs for everything they've done for me. When we first found out that Coach Bill was going to be the new head coach, we really didn't know what to expect from him. And if you don't know him, he's not easy to play for. It takes every bit of heart, sweat, and grit to satisfy him. They've not only taught me leadership on the field, but leadership off the field. They have helped me be a better teammate and put my teammates before myself. Ever since they have been together here at USA, I've seen our team bond and grow in a positive way. All the things they have taught me will contribute to my ability of being successful at the next level. Next, I want to thank Coach Gaiman. Coach Gaiman was my first pitching coach. He was the one that taught me about basic mechanics of pitching. He also taught me at a young age that there's a huge difference between being a pitcher and being a thrower. And because of his unconditional support of me, I always felt confident when I looked over him and saw him in the dugout. Next, I want to thank Coach Gary. From an early age, he saw a lot of competitiveness and raw talent within me. He pushed me to the point where I didn't think I could be pushed anymore. Through yelling at me when I needed it, complimenting me when I needed it, coaching me and pointing out the small things that make a huge difference. Throughout this journey, there were tears, joys, sweat, and love, and it was all done to bring out every ounce of ability that I had, and I can't thank you enough. Through Coach Gunn and Coach Jimmy from the time I was 8 years old, there's been unbelievable experiences and memories that we have shared and that I will cherish for the rest of my life. A few more coaches that I would like to thank. It's Coach David West, who has been critically important in advancing my pitching skills to a higher level. Coach Gary Swing for his coaching and getting me exposed to the college recruiting process. Coach Moore with USA Baseball, helping me advance not only my physical skills, but my mental skills on the mound. Coach Nick Stanford for pushing me to get in the best shape that I could be and to compete at my highest level. Coach Bianco and Coach Lafferty at Ole Miss for giving me the opportunity to play college baseball in SEC. I want to thank all of my teammates, all the way from the Coyotes to this year's team at USGA. Thank you for always being there, being great supporters of me and pushing me to do things the right way when at times that I'm lazy and I don't really feel like doing much. I wouldn't trade anything else in the world for you guys, and I can't wait to play my last season as a Bruin with you. I want to thank all my teachers and administrators that have been extremely patient at times, many times, over accommodating me with extended absences this year, and have guided me through obtaining a great education and preparing me the best they can for college. To my friends of the class of 2016, I've never been a part of a group of friends that were so close. We have literally been through everything together. Y'all have played a huge role in where I am today. Whether it is supporting me, making fun of me, or even just getting my mind off baseball and hanging out. I can't thank y'all enough for that. Y'all mean the world to me, and I can't wait to make some more great memories in the future. Next, I want to thank my family. Grandmother, thank you for being there from day one. It seems like yesterday we were throwing and hitting the ball in your backyard. And never getting tired of me saying, come on, grandmother, just one more time. Thank you for sacrificing your time to come see me play wherever that would be. Thank you, Grant, for always being a great supporter of mine and coming to watch me play over the years. It really means a lot. I want to thank two of my biggest fans that aren't with us today, but I know are watching over me. I want to thank my brother, Austin, which unfortunately came here today, for supporting me and coming to watch me play. It means a ton to me that he has done that because there's a thousand other things that he could be doing, but instead he sacrificed his time to come watch me play. Mom, Dad, there's no way I could be staying here in this situation without y'all. Y'all have done everything a child could ask for, and I'm so lucky to have parents like y'all. I've had the picture-perfect childhood because of y'all. You have raised and taught me how to be a polite, and respectful young man. Y'all have driven thousands of miles, spent thousands of dollars, sat through thousands of games and lessons. We have been on many journeys together throughout my baseball career up to this point, and I wouldn't want to spend it with anybody else except for y'all. Dad, you've been my best coach, my best friend, and the best dad the kids could ask for. I cherish getting home every night after a game and listening to you talk to me about what I did right and what I did wrong, even if I'm not in the mood to hear you. I look forward to hearing more post-game speeches in the future. Love you. Mom, you have been my biggest fan over these past years. You've built me up when I needed it and always gave me your honest opinion on everything. We've been through everything together. The ups, the downs, and you continue to amaze me every single day. You are the definition of a perfect mom. I love you. Today, I'm proud to be a Bruin. As I stand here, I see friends, family, coaches, teachers, and administrators that I've spent the last 12 plus years with. All of you have been a huge part of my life and have supported me and helped me mold into the person I am and will have a long-lasting impact on the person that I hope to become. The bar has been set high for such a great experience here at USJ, but I'm excited, humbled, and proud to be taking the next step of becoming Ole Miss Rebel. I'd like to end with one of my favorite quotes. One man's belief is stronger than 1,000 people's opinions. Go Rebels.
Really?